The speaker for class four is a leading scholar of the U.S. Civil War and Reconstruction era. His work elucidates the history of that profound struggle and considers its influence on political ideas and racial identity in America today. Before becoming a college professor, he was for 7 years a public high school teacher in his hometown of Flint, Michigan, and he still teaches summer institutes for secondary teachers and National Park Service historians. A prolific author, he has received the Bancroft Prize, the Abraham Lincoln Prize, and the Frederick Douglass Prize, among other awards for his books. And he participates actively in public history initiatives, including programs for Monticello, the Abraham Lincoln Bicentennial, and the September 11th Memorial and Museum. His most recent book, American Oracle, The Civil War in the Civil Rights Era, shows a master historian at the top of his game, elegant argument framed in a compelling narrative. It reminds us that great humanities scholarship can exhibit both force and grace. It is my privilege to introduce the class of 1954, professor of American history and director of the Center for the Study of Slavery, Resistance, and Abolition at Yale University, and president-elect of the Society of American Historians, David Blight.
It hasn't been mentioned yet, so I guess I will. For those of you who don't know, we are gathered today in what is probably the largest Civil War memorial in the United States. This building, at least as a physical building, the largest. I don't think the Lincoln Memorial is bigger than Memorial Hall. This was built by the parents and families of the Harvard men who died fighting for the Union. And as you could see, right behind us in the hall are all of their names. Let's call this for now the pleasure and pain of history. The opening sentence of the oldest book of history in Western civilization has always inspired me. I read it aloud at the beginning of every class I teach, whether the undergraduate lecture course or the graduate seminar. I always do it. In Herodotus, The History, he declares, quote, "I, Herodotus of Halicarnassus, am here setting forth my history, that time may not draw the color from what man has brought into being, nor those great and wonderful deeds manifested by both Greeks and barbarians fail of their report, and together with all of this, the reason why they fought one another." Many historians and philosophers have tried to endlessly improve on that sentence. But Herodotus captures, in the oldest sentence in the oldest history ever, the dual nature and purpose of learning and writing history. One, fashioning, in his word, the color, or the deeds, the narrative, the drama of the story, telling the story. But two, demonstrating the reasons why people did what they did, thought what they thought, created what they created, destroyed what they destroyed, or in other words, the explanation and the interpretation. However my students react to my eccentric reading of this quote at the beginning of a class, and they do usually squirm a bit, it always moves me, at least, to feel just how old, how valued, how indispensable and alive my craft really is, not only in the humanities, but to our entire public world of knowledge. We can garner enormous pleasure and joy from doing history, but in learning it, if we really face it, we also can encounter enormous pain, even terror from history. As in personal memory, so also in the collective memory that historians assemble and resist and narrate and interpret, the past is that thing we cannot live without, but also sometimes that thing we cannot live with. History, Robert Penn Warren once wrote in a single line of a poem, history, said Warren, is the thing you cannot resign from. Like Warren, one of my other favorite writers, James Baldwin, never stopped probing the nature of the past, the irresistible, if at times debilitating, hold that history and memory can have on any thoughtful person's consciousness. History, said Baldwin in a 1965 essay, I quote him, is not merely something to be read, and it does not refer merely or even principally to the past. On the contrary, the great force of history comes from the fact that we carry it within us, are unconsciously controlled by it in many ways, and history is literally present in all that we do. For Baldwin, the nonfiction voice, the Jeremiah of the civil rights movement, if Americans ever really began to learn and face their past with slavery and racism, they would be entering into what he called a dialogue with that terrifying deity called history. Most Americans do not wish to see their history as a terrifying deity. Who would? A source of painful, unfinished lessons and challenges collectively. The larger public prefers a progressive, a triumphal history, the grand narrative of a problem-solving people, a nation, as someone once put it, born perfect, which then launched itself on a career of improvement. In this country, we will likely forever struggle as on this teeter-totter between such opposite views of history, the one bracing, restorative, redemptive, inspiring, and the other authentically tragic, chastening, yet also potentially, I think, redemptive and inspiring. One view demands bright horizons from the vantage of perhaps a World War II victory parade, or John Trumbull's painting the Declaration of Independence, or Emanuel Lutz's Westward the Course of Empire, or Abraham Lincoln's crafting and signing of that magnificent Emancipation Proclamation. The other view suggests we look from the vantage first, perhaps, of the hold of a slave ship, or of the Union and Confederate dead heaped in the piles at Antietam or at Gettysburg, or the eyes in the photo of a child worker in an American factory circa 1910, or a woman who cannot feed her children gripping her apron in the depths of the Great Depression. Tragedy and triumph, pain and pleasure. We have infinite supplies of both views in our history if we look for them. If we find the unpleasant, or even the horrible or embarrassing in the past, it does not necessarily deprive us of history's pleasures, of discovery, of illumination, or simply practicing our craft. After the historian Nathan Huggins died in 1989, who was one of my mentors right here at Harvard for a short time, I wrote a retrospective essay on the whole of his life's writings, which were largely in the field of African-American history. And just for curiosity, I looked at his entry in Who's Who, where I found this wonderful statement about why he said he was a historian. I find in the study of history, wrote Nathan, the special discipline which forces me to consider peoples and ages not my own. It is the most humane of disciplines, and in ways the most humbling, for one cannot ignore those historians of the future who will look back upon us in the same way. Humane and humbled. I've always believed both of those are good and proper elements of a true scholar's temperament. One of the best and certainly most heroic books ever written on the historian's craft, and by that very title, The Historian's Craft, was that of Marc Bloch, the great French historian of feudalism and other broad subjects. Bloch, a veteran of the First World War, fled from his professorship at the Sorbonne into hiding in Strasbourg after the fall of France to the Nazis in 1940. He began writing his masterful meditation on the historian's art in 1941, it appears, as he also joined the French resistance. Chased further into hiding, he finished perhaps only about two-thirds of the book he had planned until the Nazis captured, imprisoned, and tortured him, and finally shot him in an open field with 26 other French patriots in June 1944. But in that text he left, Bloch could write under these circumstances with such a sense of humor as the following. "A good cataclysm," he said, "suits our business." Moreover, he wrote so movingly about what he called the pleasure of what all of us do. "To anyone who is not a blockhead," he declared, "all the sciences are interesting, yet each scholar finds but one that absorbs him, finding it in order further to devote himself to it, he terms it his vocation and his calling." To Bloch, history, as he put it, has its peculiar aesthetic pleasures. The spectacle, I'm quoting, "the spectacle of human activity which forms its particular object is, more than any other, designed to seduce the imagination, above all when, thanks to its remoteness in time or space, it is adorned with a subtle attachment of the unfamiliar." Ah, Bloch seemed to be saying, the wonderful pastness of the past, as it also becomes available and familiar to our imagination. Then beautifully, while writing under what seem unbearable pressures, he urged historians never to forget that they are also writers. "Let us guard against the stripping our science of its share of poetry," he warned. "Let us also beware of the inclination which I have detected in some to be ashamed of this poetic quality. It would be sheer folly to suppose that history, because it appeals strongly to the emotions, is less capable of satisfying the intellect." Bloch deeply understood the pain and the pleasure of knowing and doing history, as well as the marvelous joy of transforming research into writing. And finally, let me end by using another of my heroes to make this point. Walt Whitman wrote a short poem. He wrote a poem about everything, but he wrote a short poem entitled "To a Historian." I read it as Whitman's challenge, but also invitation to historians to dare to join him in his enterprise. Here's the poem. "You, who celebrate bygones, who have explored the outward, the surfaces of the races, the life that has exhibited itself, who have treated of man as the creature of politics, aggregates, rulers, and priests, I, habitant of the Alleghenies, treating of him as he is in himself, in his own rights, pressing the pulse of the life that has seldom exhibited itself, the great pride of man in himself, chanter of personality, outlining what is yet to be, I project the history of the future." Historians should answer Whitman and say, "Really? You think as poet you are the only one who can get to where you get in the human predicament? Maybe, but just watch us, Walt. Neither poets, nor historians, nor scientists can ever stand alone in exploring and explaining the past or the present or the future, since all memory, however painful or pleasurable, is in some way prelude. We have to chant together." Thank you.